Okay, so we continue with the next episode of this interview, of course. Okay, so I just remind you what we discussed last time. Last time we discussed that there was an interesting and useful way of thinking of superconformal transformations in superspace. Okay, we discussed that superconformal transformations could be thought of as redefinitions of the z coordinate and the theta coordinate in a way that causes the derivative, the supersymmetric derivative d theta, to scale over g, isn't it? And we discussed how that worked and what that implied in general, in particular for the transformation of the transformation under superconformal transformations of superconformal primary fields. Okay, that's an interesting story that one can develop in more detail there. The only aspect of it that I'm going to use in today's class, or the aspect of it that I'll remind you, is this: that suppose you've got a superfield phi. Okay. Suppose you've got a superfield phi. Okay. So that's some function of z bar theta theta bar. So everything splits into holomorphic and anti-holomorphic. So I just think of z and theta. Suppose we've got a superfield phi, and the superfield is a primary superfield in the sense that we define it. That is, it transforms homogeneously with a factor of del theta to the power 2h under superconformal transformations. Then in the last class, we noticed that this implied that the zero component of the superfield was a superconformal primary operator in our old sense. Okay? That is, that the zero component of the superfield was an operator such that it obeyed the OPs that we in the earlier lectures demanded of it. That it was a conformant primary and was also annihilated by the supersymmetric generators in the appropriate fashion. Okay? And the second thing that we understood about this is that if this phi had an expansion phi plus theta times psi, then psi was equal to g minus half. Okay? So if we have a superfield, that is a superconformal primary in the sense that we defined in the last lecture, that is a transformed under superconformal transformations in an appropriate fashion, appropriate geometric fashion, then its zero component, its path that's independent of theta, is an ordinary superconformal primary. Kind of superconformal primaries we've talked about in previous lectures. And this object is a descendant of the superconformal primary, in particular for g minus half. Okay? So this of the discussion that we had last lecture, that would be interesting in other contexts to continue more fully and develop more fully for various reasons. The only part that I'm going to use in today's lecture and the next few lectures are these facts. So I'm reminding you of them. Any questions or comments about this? Okay. Now, before we proceed, and for the reason that we're going to use this, let me tell you how the X and Psi CFT can be combined in this nice geometrical fashion. Into a superconformal field. Okay? So, as you know, as we've already discussed, the conformal field theory made up of a free boson and a free fermion, both left moving and right moving. Okay? It's a superconformal field. I'm going to explain how that works geometrically in the sense of superspace. Okay? So, define a super multiple X, which is equal to X plus right psi theta times psi plus I theta bar theta. And plus theta theta bar. Let me start explaining how. To start with, the action can be written as follows. The action can be written as 1 by 4 pi d2 theta d2 z d theta of capital X times d theta bar. Okay, here I've set alpha prime equals 2, or equivalently I've rescaled the scalar field in a way that was set alpha prime equals 2, just to make a formula. So this. Okay, so that instead of 1 over 2 pi alpha prime, the scalar part of the action will come to 1 over 4 pi. We can restore that by redefining this x field, or the scalar part of the x field, as next. Okay, let's see how this works. Let's see what this action is. Okay, so capital X was this object. Now let's evaluate d theta of capital X and d theta bar of capital X. Oh, by the way, something I don't think I said last class that is obvious. Suppose you've got a primary superfield in the sense that we defined it. Then we take supersymmetric derivatives thereof. It remains a primary superfield. In more or less, it remains a primary superfield, but its H increases by half. Okay? And this you can easily convince yourself just from the fact that this d theta transforms in a nice way under superconformal transformations. So for X transformed in a nice way under superconformal transformations, and d theta does, the two things add up, the weight adds up. Okay? So this dx here is formally a primary, is one of these superconformal superfields. And we make up an action taking d theta of x times d theta of x, which gives us other superconformal superfields. And although I'm not going to present this to you, one can check how this major term cancels and, transforms under superconformal transformations, and how these guys transform under superconformal transformations. This x by itself is a field of weight 0. Its lowest term is this guy x, which has weight 0. Okay, and one can check just geometrically that this object is geometrically superconformal. Okay, by just looking at how the volume factor transforms under superconformal transformations, and how these two, the transformations of these two are obvious. Because x does not transform superconformal. That's the statement that it's a weight 0 kind of object. Okay? And so then this d theta picks up, makes it transform in the appropriate fashion. Okay? And that's exactly cancelled by this volume factor. In terms of purely dimensional analysis, d theta of x is an object of weight half. So this is an object of weight half comma half under holomorphic and anti-holomorphic weight. Now, d2z is weight minus 1 comma minus 1. Okay? But this d2 theta here has weight half comma half. Not minus half comma minus half, as you might be tempted to think. Because a fermionic integral is actually a fermionic derivative. It removes a coordinate. Okay, so that's how the weight stands. And the important point about the measure is that it that not only is its weight half comma, sorry, minus half comma minus half, but it transforms under superconformal transformations, like a primary of weight minus half comma minus half. So it exactly cancels the transformation. Okay? So the general rule is that in order to build a superconformally invariant action, you take this measure, this d to theta times d to z, and multiply it by a superfield, the superconformal primary of weight half comma half. Okay? And this is an example in which we built a half comma half. We built a half comma half. Okay? Fine. So let's proceed. Let's see how this works. So this del theta of x bar of x is what? This is equal to, well, remember what d theta was. D theta was equal to del theta, and the convention was a plus or minus. Somebody can remind me? Plus theta times del theta. D theta bar was equal to del theta bar plus theta bar times theta. Okay? So now let's evaluate this object on this object. X plus I theta psi plus I theta bar psi bar plus theta theta bar. Okay? So the first object becomes what? Let's do the del theta bar. That gives you 0 on x. Here it gives you I psi. This is 0. And this part is plus theta bar. Okay? Now let's look at this part. This part is 0 for any term that contains a theta. So it's non-zero only in theta times del zx. Okay? And it's non-zero on plus I theta theta bar del z of psi. Okay? So this first term is the subject. Let's also evaluate the second term. So that's very simple. We get I psi bar plus theta times z. You just replace theta by theta bar. And del z by del z bar. So theta bar del z bar z plus I, probably minor. Plus I theta bar theta del z bar. Okay, so that's the product of del theta of x and del theta bar of x. And then we're supposed to take this guy and integrate over d to theta. Now the integral over d to theta just picks out the term that is the coefficient of theta theta bar in the subject. So where do we get theta theta bar? Well, one place is to take something that has theta theta bar in one of these terms and multiply by the constant. Okay? So from those terms you get you get the terms that are of the form psi bar del z psi bar plus psi del z bar psi. Okay? Which is the action for the free particles. The action that says psi can be holomorphic and psi bar again. I'm skipping I's and so on. Okay, well, where else do you get theta theta bar? Another option is to multiply the theta term here with the theta bar. And that gives you del z x del z bar x. Which is the action for the free bosons. Okay? Do you have any other options? Well, yes. There is another option. And the other option is to multiply to multiply this guy with this guy. Or that doesn't make it right, that should have worked, yes. Yeah, that's theta bar squared and that's theta squared. Exactly. Good. So what remains is an x squared. And that's the full action. Now this one is very familiar. That's the free action for free bosons. This part is very familiar. It's free action for free bosons. But what's this term? What's the P left? Well, this is the kind of thing that often happens when you try to write supersymmetric theories in superspace. in order to get things to transform nicely in the supermarket, we had to introduce what I call auxiliary fields. But dynamics tells me that these auxiliary fields have no dynamics. In this case, what's important here is that there are no derivative terms in the system. It's not a propagating field. And this equation of motion says it, you see. Equation of motion tells you that. Okay? Firstly, it's free, so that's an exact statement. But more generally, when you've got a field that's not propagating, it's infinitely massive, so it can always be integrated out. You know, giving you a local interaction. Okay? In this case, it's really trivial. It's like just omitting it. So everywhere there's an F, in the full quantum theory, this F will be set to 0. Okay? So F is just not there. This is usually the situation with the auxiliary fields. In more interesting situations in a theory that's not free, F may not turn out to be 0, but may turn out to be something specified in terms of the probability. That's the way it happens in supersymmetric theories, four dimensions, for instance. The term that's called the F term there is equal to the superpotential, the derivative of the superpotential. Okay? But in this case, it's all very simple. Okay. So you see that this rather compact looking expression reproduces the action for both the free boson and the free quark, yeah? And could have been one way to introduce this idea of superconformal XI system. Okay, just one other quick comment about this XI system in the superspace before we proceed. We won't use it, but it's so sort of neat that it's worth saying. The thing that's really neat about this is that suppose you have x of theta. Okay, I'll only present. Let's call it theta 1 zeta. 1. And I'm not writing in the notation, but it's also a function of theta 1 bar zeta. Times x of theta 2 zeta 2. Okay? So suppose I try to work out the OP. Let me try just to work out the expectation value. Okay? In superspace. Okay. What object do I get? Well, I'll tell you what object you get, and then I tell you how it could have. Okay, let me first tell you the answer, and then we'll understand it. The answer is this is equal to, in the conventions in which we set alpha prime equals 2, it's minus of log of z1 minus z2 plus beta 1 beta 2. The whole thing pass. Now let's look at the term that is theta here and theta there. Oh, by the way, this mod squared should be read as minus log of z1 minus z2 plus theta1 theta2 minus log of z1 bar minus z2 bar plus theta1 bar. This clearly shows also the separation between holomorphic and anti-holomorphic. You know, that cross-term holomorphic and anti-holomorphic, that also we know. And then the last thing to check is that this theta1 theta2 term turns out to be correct. So the coefficient of theta1 theta2 should be the OP between side, between the two sides. So how do we get the coefficient of theta1 theta2? We Taylor expand this. So Taylor expanding this gives us minus theta1 theta2 by z1 minus 2. So this log, better to say, this log is equal to minus log of z1 minus z2 minus 1 over z1 minus z2 into theta1 theta2. This is equal to this. Why is it equal to that? Because any function of bosonic plus fermionic variables should be thought of is by definition equal to the Taylor expansion in the fermionic. And in this case, the Taylor expansion part. The Taylor expansion here just stops at first order because theta 1 squared is equal to theta 2 squared is equal to 0. So this is just a fancy way of writing this formula. And this part, of course, reproduces the OBs of the three fermions. Is this clear? Okay. So, firstly, this is a neat way of packaging. But now I want to claim that we could have guessed this answer in superspace. We could have guessed this answer in superspace very simply. Yeah. And I've got to explain how that works. You see, if you remember when we were discussing conformal symmetry long, long ago, we deduced the form that correlation functions had to be functions of z1 minus z2 and one or two other things about the correlation functions merely from conformal theories. Okay, actually powers and the two-point functions would vanish unless weights were equal. Now, you can deduce the functional dependence of correlation functions, in particular these two-point functions, on coordinates and supercoordinates by similar considerations. Okay? The thing that told us that something has to be a function only of z1 minus z2 was translational dependence. You move z1 by a, you move z2 by a, nothing should change. Okay? Now, there's a similar consideration here. So, well, clearly things have to continue to be functional only of z1 minus z2. Because translational invariance continues to be a subgroup of superconformal functions. But in general, you might think that it could be an arbitrary function of theta 1 and theta 2 as well. Okay? So now let's impose the condition of invariance of these functions under fermionic translations. That is supersymmetry. Okay? Now you remember the last class we deduced that under a superconformal transformation parameterized by this function V and eta, delta Z, let me set V to Z, so just the fermionic part. Delta Z was equal to epsilon into minus I epsilon times theta and theta. This I is the irritating convention of proteins that we didn't use last class. Okay, let's write down the centimeters over here. And delta theta is equal to minus I epsilon density. Okay, we absorb minus I and epsilon. Epsilon is just an infinitesimal. Okay, so under delta Z, under delta Z is equal to under delta Z is equal to epsilon theta eta And delta theta is equal to epsilon, is equal to epsilon times theta. This whole thing was invented. And this all correlation functions must be invented. Okay? So let's try to see if we can find the combination of z1 minus z2, theta 1 and theta 2 that satisfies this correlation. The first combination is obvious. It's theta 1 minus theta 2. Because each theta shifts by theta, and that cancels in the difference. Okay? So this is the closest analog of z1 minus z2. Theta 1 minus theta 2 is obviously invariant under Fourier relations. Okay. However, there is another more interesting combination. And that is z1 minus z2 plus theta 1 theta 2. Okay? This is more interesting combination comes, you know, stem from the fact that z and theta both shift under Fourier relations. Okay? Let's see. Let's take delta of this object. Okay? So let's take delta of this object. So delta of this object with z1 gives us a theta 1. Well, epsilon can get rid of. Epsilon can lose already. Theta 1 times theta. Z2 gives us minus theta 2 times theta. And theta 1, 2 we have to be careful about. Okay? So the first one gives us plus eta theta 2 plus theta 1 eta. And the thing that we have to be careful about is that eta is negative. Okay? So this guy, when we bring it here, picks up a minus sign. So this cancels this and this. Is this clear? Oh, did I do it the wrong way around? The way I wrote it, it adds. It's canceling. Either with my transformation law or on my relative sign. You see, if I flip this relative sign, so I've messed up on something and getting it messed up on. Okay, so functions here z1 minus z2 minus theta 1 theta 2, that's written anything. Minus theta. So this should also be, which we would have noticed if we were. If we were noticed if we were more careful looking at exactly. Okay. So the lesson is that notice, by the way, that z1 minus z2 by itself is not invariant under superposition. Like, z1 minus z2 transformed by this object, which needed this theta 1 theta 2 cancel. So there are only two objects that are invariant under both bosonic and fermionic translations. The first is z1 minus z2 minus theta 1 theta 2, and the second is theta 1 minus theta 2. So any correlation function that you write down has to be a function of only these two objects. Okay, so now we could have without any work written down this answer. The way we could have done it is that we could have said, well, we know the bosonic things, it's this. The only way it could be invariant is by fixing it up like this. Okay, now there could have been in addition some function of purely theta 1. Or some function of theta 1 minus theta 2 multiplying some other function of z1 minus z2. But then you could argue quickly using your knowledge of things. The right correlators, this could work. Okay? So supercomponent invariance in this way unifies various aspects of the things that we've been studying. This geometric way of looking at supercomponent modeling unifies various aspects of the things we've studied. Okay, just again, we're not going to use it very much, but just because it's sort of cute and these are the things we talked about, let me tell you about how this works for the BC CFT. Okay, for the BC CFT, for any lambda, you remember we had a superconformer theory for the BC CFT combining with beta gamma for any value of gamma. And the way this works in superspace goes as follows. B you define as beta plus beta times B. And C you define as C plus beta times gamma. You might have wondered, how do I know which factor to put the theta on? You can deduce that from weights. If you remember, our BC CFT had weights, algebra, lambda, and 1 minus 1. Or 2 minus 1? 2 minus 1.
2n minus
1. 2n minus 1. 2? Yeah, exactly. So, 2 and minus 1. Lambda 1 minus 1. Okay? And the beta gamma system has related weights. So, we have to remember that. So, this, let's think of this as the weight of B. So, lambda was 2. And let's think of this as the weight of C. So, lambda was minus 1. And the beta gamma system had weights lambda minus half and 1 minus lambda, I think, plus half. Let's check whether that's true. Okay, so this whole object then has weight lambda minus half. Because theta has weight minus half. So, this object has weight lambda minus half, this object. Okay? On the other hand, this whole object has weight lambda minus. Has weight 1 minus lambda. Because this object has weight 1 minus lambda, and this object has weight 1 minus lambda. Okay? So, that, if you were to put them together in the super field, this is basically the only way to do it. Okay? And now, putting that in the same superfield, what could the correlation functions be? Well, firstly, what could the action be? This I'll let you check the integral B d theta C. Integral B d theta C works. So let's very quickly see how that works. Remember the general rule. We want to get something that is of weight half. We want to get something that is of weight we want to get something that is weight half. Half. Then under both the left and right. Okay? The d theta bar makes this thing of weight half under the right hand force. Right? It's the only thing that has any weight under the right hand force. Because B and C are transform purely on the left hand force. Okay? And now let's look. We said that this guy had weight lambda minus half. And this guy had weight one. And then you get weight half. What's the difference?
Does anything depend on us from writing such a thing called four-dimension also? Like, normally, because this D has this weird thing, like, the leading thing has a fermionic nature. So, generally we think of superfields as having an expansion, but the leading thing is some scalar.
fermionic superfields, even there for
energies.
And an example is W1. You know, when we study gauge theories, there's the field strength superfield. This W alpha, which starts with the gauge. So, I mean, not only can you routinely do absorption. Okay, yeah, but you're right. So this superfield here, C is anti-commuting, whereas B is a commuting. Is a commuting object. Yeah, I mean, you're right about that. And it's this d theta here that makes it always commuting plus anti-commuting. In fact, we have only one theta. Okay, you can try to work out, you know, what the action looks like. You see, all the derivatives with respect to theta bar is zero. C depends on the unit. But there is a term that is theta bar times anti-holomorphic derivative. That's not zero, and in fact cancels against theta. Okay, so you have to keep, that's the only term that can contribute, and then you have to keep one of the two theta terms. You cancel the theta bar term, because that goes from the derivative, but you need a theta to cancel this. So you can either keep the theta as a B expansion, which will give you a BC, or you can keep the theta in the C expansion, which will give you gamma. Okay. So you can easily check that this will give you the action that we're used to. And now, it's sort of nice that the BCs, you can unify all our discussion of BC and beta gamma two-by functions by the following device. B of Z1 theta 1, C of Z2 theta 2. This is equal to theta 1 minus theta 2 divided by Z1 minus Z2. Actually, I've written this Z1 minus Z2 minus theta 1 minus theta 1 theta 2 to be fancy, just to display its manifest invariance. But if you Taylor expand with this theta 1 theta 2, it's 0. It's multiplied by either theta 1 or theta 2. So that's saying that we don't need this term. Okay, this term is equal to theta 1 minus theta 2 over Z1 minus Z2.
But this makes it
manifestly superconformal, right? But if you want to read off in components, just drop this in your mind. And then the term that is proportional to theta 1 is B with C, and that gives you a Z1 minus Z2 for B and C. The term that is proportional to theta 2 is beta with gamma, that gives you one of the Z1 minus Z2 for beta. You can check all the various signs and so on. Good. But it all works. Okay? So this very beautiful story here involving writing superconformal field theories. Actually, supersymmetric field theories as well. It's even more beautiful than superconformal. Right? There's superconformal field theories in superspace. And this is a story we could develop and could talk a lot about. Especially when we add to the amount of supersymmetry in the world sheet, in many interesting ways. But we're not going to pause to do that here. Maybe later in the course. Okay? So, now we end our formal discussion of the development of superspace in 1 plus 1 dimension theory, and then to using this to discuss scattering amplitudes of the world sheet in the string. But any questions or comments? Okay, since we built this whole mechanism up, okay, there's one thing that I'll immediately use. And this use because, we'll use it. Or maybe I should first tell you why we're doing that. Okay, now let's return to developing scattering amplitudes in this chain. Okay, we're interested in computing scattering amplitudes. To start with, only on the sphere. It's just three-level scattering amplitudes, so that we don't have to deal with issues involving. Okay. Now, at the end of the last class we already discussed some issues that came up in the study. And the first issue that came up in the study went as follows. We discussed how on the sphere, just the anomaly of the zero mode current of the five. Okay. So for this discussion, I think it's useful to remind everyone of the results of the quantization of the beta analysis. Okay. So you remember we had this beta gamma superconformal Bose system, and you remember that we bosonized the system in the following fashion. Beta was equal to e to the power minus pi. Beta was equal to e to the power minus pi times what was it? Del the symbol, and gamma was equal to e to the power plus pi times theta, where zeta was of weight 0, eta of weight 1, and these two together, zeta and eta, formed a BC system. Also, this phi conformal field theory was a free boson theory, but with a certain background charge. Okay? So, the translational current for phi, now the operator del phi, was not a genuine primary field. There was an anomaly in this between the OP of T with del phi, and that anomaly led us to conclude that del mu j mu for this translational current was not zero, it was equal to some number times integral r. Okay? And that number worked out for the weights that were relevant to the superstring, that number worked out to be equal to 2 when integral r was what it is of the sphere. Okay. So then you gave me you remember those very similar issues in the BCs. The BC conformal field theory, where this del mu j mu was related to the number of zero modes of B minus number of zero modes of C. This is a very similar story of the beta gamma system. But you can think of it directly in bosonic language. You have this bosonic current, you compute the stress tensor over B with the current, it gives you something not zero, and then using techniques we developed since the beginning, you translate that to an anomaly. Okay, and is there anything else I want to remember? The other thing I want to remind you is that phi of z, phi of 0, is equal to plus. I think plus z1 minus z2, if we just get to be minus z. Yeah, but it was the wrong sign. The wrong sign will be each other. Wait, the plus minus, I guess plus minus straight. Yeah, it's in a little bit. I think it's minus. I mean, it was the wrong sign boson, but then we absorb that in writing vertex operators as e to the power phi and e to the power minus phi, rather than e to the power I phi. So, goes on to be technically said. Okay, good. All of this sufficiently familiar that it doesn't seem mysterious. I know you don't remember the formulas I did today, so lecture. So you know when you look it up, you know that you have all this. Okay, good. Now, you remember the issue that we first came up, and that went as follows. Look, as in a development, you know, of scattering amplitudes in the bosonic string, we're motivated by this by the following idea. We've got some worldsheet string, And there's a little tube coming in here, some more tubes coming in here, going out. Okay, that represents states coming. States are the cylinders, and this thing is basically a cylinder. Okay, we want to compute the amplitude for this object. And our idea was that this whole thing is conformally bent. So we'll map this conformally to this picture with the vertex operator using the state operator. Similarly, everything here will be mapped to the vertex operator insertion using the state operator. This intuitive picture would tell us that the objects that we should put at the origin are the vertex operators that correspond to the states. Now, we know what the vertex operators that correspond to states in the superstring are. We worked with that in great detail over the last 2-3 months. And the vertex operators that correspond to states are appropriate lattice superconformal primes. That means e to the power minus 5 were in the inner sector, or e to the power minus 5 by 2 in the Ramon sector. Because e to the power minus 5 was the vertex operator corresponding to the vacuum of the beta gamma CFT in the inner sector, and e to the power minus 5 by 2 was the vertex operator corresponding to the vacuum of the beta gamma CFT in the Ramon sector, as we worked out in detail. Okay? But if we really implement this, it can't really work. It can't really work because suppose we're interested in scattering four NS sector fields. We'll get a factor of e to the power minus pi in each of these objects times whatever comes from the matter part. Now, we've said that that correlation functions vanish unless the net charge on in pi of insertions on the sphere is equal to 2. As a bit lower normally in the translation correct currently. That 2 wouldn't be 0. Okay? Then it's not 0, something mixed. Okay? So, if we use the rules that we just insert vertex operators as obtained from the state operator map, okay? If we use that rule, then the bounding is 0 unless we're interested in scattering 2 guys. With 2 scattering, 2 is not scattering. Okay? So something's wrong. Okay? Now, how do we cure this problem? Okay. I'm going to first give you the technical answer. You get 0 because the net charge of that whole thing, for instance, with K scattering, with K NS sector object, would be K. But the only way to get non-zero correlators is if the net charge of the scale is 2. You see, you think of it this way. You should think of it like initial time and final time. You've got some operators inserted in initial time. If there's no anomaly in the curve, then the charge of the operators inserted in an initial time is equal to the charge inserted at final time. Because ingoing initially, outgoing finally, that gives you net insertion 0 for the charge. Now, because this current has an anomaly, we don't get 0, but we get something fixed that's equal to 2. So then, the only way to get non-zero correlators, okay, is if this net charge is equal to 2. Or perhaps more formally speaking, suppose you had some e to the power m1 phi, let's say e to the power phi, e to the power phi, e to the power phi, e to the power phi. And had translations in phi really been symmetric, then let's translate this object. Okay, let's translate it by A. Then we can prove that this object is equal to itself, then e to the power 4a. Which means that this contraction is 0. Now, this translation is not quite symmetric, because there's an anomaly factor, which reduces this e to the power 4a to e to the power 4a minus 2. But the amplitude is 0 unless 4a is 2. Okay? So it can't be that we just put the vertex operators due to the states and under the state operator map inside our coordinates. That doesn't work. It will just be the same. Okay. Now, at the end of the last lecture, I told you the way out. You see, even in the bosonic string, we didn't really put the vertex operators dual to the states under the state operator map. Always. There were two options. There were some vertex operators that were integrated with the machine. And those guys had no scene insertion. The scene insertion is what you get by the state operator map. Okay? On the other hand, there were the guys that were not integrated and they had the scene insertion. So you see, the careful analysis of the path integral that gave us string theory told us that it was wrong to think of these vertex operators all being as the guys who got from the state operator map. Some of them were, but others were of this integrated nature. Okay? And so in the course set, they did not come from the state operator map. So you might think, well, what I'll do is just by hand put two of these let's say that we're dealing with four NSF sections. I'll put two of these operators with an equal power minus 5. And the other two operators I'll remove the equal power minus 5. That's like removing the C's in the integrated vertex operators in bosonic string theory. You might be tempted to think, okay, that's a good thing to do. But if you did that, nothing would work. What would not work? Well, for instance, the answer would depend on which operator you remove the C, e to the power minus 5 from. And so on. I mean, you get all kinds of random operators. You won't get any coupling or negative non-states and so on. Anyway, if you just do random things in string theory, it doesn't work. Okay. So what's the right way of thinking of this? Well, I'll first tell you the words, and then we'll understand this more technically. The words go as follows. Well, words, this is so much as an analogy. The analogy goes as follows. You see, in the bosonic string, apart from stripping away the C, what we did was integrate the operator over the worksheet. Now, integration here is replaced by the idea of integration. You see, integration of the worksheet made sense for things that where we were fixing worksheet translational and so on semantics. The beta gamma have to do with superspace. So you might think what you should do is to strip away into the mind. Suppose you have superconformal primary of this stuff. Strip away this guy, but then also take O and integrate it over superspace. This is equal to g minus half tilde. Okay? That is, replace O by the integral over superspace of O and then strip away to the power minus 5. That would be our way of making an analogy with what we did in the bosonic string. Okay? This turns out to be the correct answer. Which, and it's for this reason that I introduced the superspace. Basically to motivate the statement. However, in order to see that it's the correct answer, to see that it's a sensible answer, okay, we need to do a little more work. So I'm planning to do that. But firstly, you understand this answer. So the answer is that, for instance, if we're establishing only Ramon sector operators, sorry, only Neverswell sector operators, say we were doing this capturing of 4, we would choose 2 to be in the usual picture with e to the power minus 5 and so on. And 2 of them have no e to the power minus 5, but then 4 is replaced by b to theta of 4. That is g minus half. That's the rule. Of course, if you had to go scattering n, you would choose 2 to be in the usual picture, and the remaining n minus 2 to be in the usual picture. Well, as I've been shown now, for instance, it will not matter which one is. You choose how. This will not mess up. Well, we'll see. You see, there are immediate issues here. Because this object is not a superconformal primary. This object was. This object isn't. So there are immediate issues about whether this all makes sense. Okay? I'm going to explain to you that it does. But this is the rule. And you understand this. And you understand the rule.
So basically the rule is to take leave the two operators and for the rest of the lines, instead of putting the power minus 1, you just apply g minus half.
G minus half, g plus half, of course, is not an object, it's an operator. So descend, replace all by 1.
Replace e to the power minus 5 o.
Replace e to the power minus 5 o by a particular descent. Okay? Now let me try to explain to you why this rule makes sense. Okay. I'll keep this on the board for you. Now, in order to see why this rule makes sense, let me start from a slightly arcane place. And the arcane place is in clearing up a loose end from our discussion of bosonization of the beta dot. Okay. We claimed that the beta gamma system was bosonized into this whatever, zeta, eta, phi system. That was our claim. And the content of that claim is that every correlation function computed in the first theory can be computed in the second theory as well, when you make the appropriate replacements of operators. And you remember that our proof of the statement was essentially to say that the poles and zeros of OPs assured us that correlation functions of the two sides would be equal just because they have the same poles and up to some overall normalization. One could argue about it. Okay. However, there is one serious issue here, and that is that overall normalization might be zero if you use xrom. And we run into that serious issue when studying this theorem. What about the index? See, suppose we were interested in computing the kind of correlation functions that arise in string theory. Okay? The kind of correlation functions that arise in string theory. That is, we have insertions of e to the power minus 5 types of matter stuff. The matter is irrelevant for the discussion we have asked. Then insertion of e to the power minus 5 plus 5. But no insertions of the beta gamma CFTs, of this eta, zeta eta CFT. Okay? Then, all the correlation functions computed in the bosonized language would be zero. For very simple reason. The simple reason is that zeta is weight zero. And so has a zero motor in every manner, in particular. Just a constant. It's function. Okay? And integral over that zero mod gives you zero, because the insertions that we're interested in have no factors of zeta. Okay? And similarly, if you were computing just an insertion of beta and gamma, you know, the way we would do that is by contracting zeta with eta, contracting phi with phi, but that leaves nothing to soak up the integral of the zero. So the idea that insertions of, you know, making this replacement that you get and just putting it into the zeta eta field there, that will give you the same correlators, that can't be quite right. It's always the GZ. At least in examples where we know that the beta gamma correlator is not zero, we get zero. Is this clear? So what is the right rule? You see, what was our derivation really? Our derivation really said that, you know, if we've got these non-zero correlation functions, they have to be proportional to each other. So is there a way of salvaging this derivation? This sounds bad, right? It sounds like I'm leading you down the government path. I made a very formal argument, but it doesn't make any sense. document is salvageable. Even and the salvaging when it's taken through is very important. And the formal argument tells you that it is salvaged if you is correct for the following proposition. That is, for any beta gamma insertion in your conformal field theory, you make the corresponding insertions of these operators, but also add by hand a single insertion of zeta. Okay? Because we're not interested in the beta gamma conformal field theory for itself, let's restrict our attention to those correlation functions that arise in string. Namely, the correlation functions in which correlation functions are totally independent of zeta. They only verify. Okay? We calculate those correlators, which we do the usual games in the phi CFT, but we also put by hand a single insertion of the operator zeta at some point in the virtual stream. Now you can ask at which point in the virtual stream. And the answer is it doesn't matter. Because the only role of that insertion is to soak up the integral of the zero mode. So that integral gives us factor of the function. You know, it gives us the zero mode function evaluated at that point. But because zeta is a constant, it is weight zero, the zero mode is the constant function. Okay? So the constant function is the same evaluated at any point. So this is a very important point. It says that when we are computing correlation functions in string theory, we're supposed to compute the correlation function in the phi CFT and the eta zeta CFT. The eta zeta CFT plays almost no role. It plays almost no role in anything, except for one thing. That if you just did the integral over the eta zeta CFT, you get zero, unless you also have the insertion of zeta. So let's just put that there. And that insertion does not, you know, it continues to give you translationally invariant correlation functions. Because its only role in life is to soak up the zeta. There's a more elaborate discussion that can be had if you're interested in more elaborate correlators involving non-trivial functions of zeta. But we won't get to it. Okay. So, now we understand that the kind of correlation functions that we used to calculate in string theory have an insertion of this zeta. Now, now you might be worried that this insertion messes up many things in string theory. Okay? And the kind of thing that might worry you is the following. Look. Suppose I've got some bunch of vertex operators inserted in there, and I've also got the insertion of my zeta. Now, this vertex operator is BRST closed. Suppose I add something BRST trivial. So I put a BRST trivial insertion. So some operator with a BRST current subject. QBRST. Now, this is always zero. This is supposed to be zero. BRST trivial operators are supposed to be coupled. The way it usually works is that this is a sphere actually. You take this circle and unwind it around to the other end of the sphere. That leaves little loops surrounding each of these guys. They're all BRST closed. So those loops vanish. However, what about this guy? So it leaves a little loop circulating this. Okay, does that vanish? I mean, what's going on? Okay, so this motivates you to study the following object. It motivates you to study the object that you get by integrating J and BRST on zeta. It's clear your interest to understand that object if you want to understand decoupling of data. Okay, so we didn't understand it actually. Because the beta has to be an interesting object for the reasons we described earlier. Doesn't sound like a mock. We're going to study in more detail that you might think is necessary. So let's go ahead and do that. Okay. want to do is to compute this. So what we have to do is to take, we have to compute the pole in the VRS current with zero. We want the pole. We want the path of the pole. Okay? Now, of course, there's a straightforward way of doing it. The straightforward way of doing it is to take the expression for the VRS current that we derived a couple of months ago in terms of beta gamma, bosonize that expression, and then do the computation. That is straightforward and painful, and one could do it. That's not the approach I'm going to follow. I'm going to follow Kulchin's to give you a trick derivation of this residue, which is sort of quite neat. Okay. Now, so this trick derivation of the object I'm interested in. Well, one more thing I should write down here. I should write down the structure of the VRST. Got it. Let me clear this part out. Okay, first I'm just going to quote to you what the VRST current is. I'm quoting 10.5 from 0.21 in the book. There's nothing we'd written down long ago. CTM plus gamma TS. This is the matter part, bosonic part, matter fermion. Matter bosonic stress tensor, matter fermion stress tensor. Plus BC delta. Plus 3 by 4 del C beta. Plus 1 by 4 C del beta. Minus 3 by 4 C beta del. Minus beta minus B gamma squared. This is the expression for the VRST current. This horrible huge expression is the expression for the VRST current. Okay, so it's this object that we have to take with zeta and find. Okay, so how are we going to do it? Well, the way we're going to do it is to note two things. The first thing we know it is that it is something sort of obvious. Suppose I take the gamma field and I look at the OP with any function of beta gamma. This function is a function of beta gamma, but evaluated from 0. Can somebody tell me what we get? Suppose I try to compute this OP. I take gamma of red with any function of beta and gamma, no derivatives, just beta and gamma, evaluated from 0. What am I going to get? What are the contractions? Gamma contracts with what? Gamma OP. I'm looking at, I'm looking for the pole part. The singular part. We can gamma commute. But it does matter, they expand it, and then what?
Then you use the opposite of gamma and
beta. Betas? So suppose you, with gamma with beta is what? It's 1 over z in some side. What about gamma with beta square? Two beta over z. What about beta to the n? Would be n beta to the n minus 1. Okay. You see that this is going to be del f with respect to beta of beta gamma by z plus z. Okay, so this is a quite general statement, just sort of boring as obvious. Okay, so you take any gamma with any function of beta and gamma, and that function gets the path that is irregular, the path that is singular, Yes, it's just the differential of the function. Okay. Now the second thing that is a little dodgier to understand is the following. You might remember that let's evaluate the OP between beta and e to the power plus or minus 5. Let's evaluate between gamma, okay, and e to the power. Let's evaluate this over here. Now, you see, e to the power minus 5 evaluated at 0. Gamma is e to the power 5 times eta. The eta goes through. So what we want is the e to the power 5 e to the power minus 5. The e to the power 5 e to the power minus 5 over here is very simple. You use the fact that log, that the two-point function is minus log. So this gives you z times normal order beta of z e to the power phi of z e to the power minus phi of z. Okay, and this has to be gamma of z with e to the power minus 5 has an OP that starts as z. Now, when we were dealing with fermionic fields, we were very familiar with such OPs. And when we were dealing with fermionic fields, we were very familiar with such OPs. For instance, C with itself had an OP label started with z, just from anti commutative. C of 0 times A of 0 is 0. Then expanding you start with 7. Okay? But this is more unusual when we're dealing with bosonic fields. Okay? So what this operator is, so the question I'm going to ask is, suppose I were to try to rewrite this operator as some function, as some operator purely in beta gamma terms. Okay? Suppose I was going to try to write it as some insertion in terms of beta gamma. What kind of insertion can I write that would have the property that if I took a gamma field in the unit, this object would go to zero like z if these points approached. Okay. What this insertion is some insertion that forces the gamma field to go to zero where you insert that object. Okay? And we're aware, of course, of a local function that does that. It's the object delta. Suppose you put an insertion of this object into the path. Then you would be integrating, not over all fields, but only over those field configurations such that gamma, the value of the field gamma was zero at the origin. So then in that path integral, if you try to evaluate an insertion of gamma near zero, this thing would appear in the Taylor expansion. Okay? And so would start off as z. give you an interpretation. You know, there are other things you would have to want to check with this interpretation. This is quite a singular sort of insertion. So, I'm not sure if you should think of it as a literal formula, a way of thinking. But anyway, there is a way of thinking of this formula, at least in some sort of mnemonic, of thinking of e to the power minus pi is the insertion of the delta function of gamma. Notice it's not the delta function of beta. Because if you take e to the power minus pi and take the OBU with beta, that will give you a pole rather than a vector z. Because it goes the other way. Okay? So it's again there are various things that you might want to think about and check here. But let's just move on, accepting this rough interpretation. If for no other reason, just as in order to motivate this quick and dirty derivation of what we're going to get here, you should think of this as perhaps motivation. This serious derivation would be much more involved, but much more straightforward. That is bosonizing J the other thing. Okay? So if you don't like this, there are many things to exploit. You might be able to make this interpretation solid, but there are many things to exploit. We're not going to try to do that. Let's just go ahead. But any questions about this?
For example, what happens if we tackle such a thing with beta?
Well?
What happens if we tackle such a thing with beta?
With the beta field, we get 1 over z. We get a 1 over z there.
The delta function like this?
What?
The delta function.
The delta, yeah, that, you see, not obviously, it would look like you should get delta prime, right? Let's see, maybe we can make that picture. Well, let's see. Let's try to approach the beta. I'm not sure if I'm going to make this work, but suppose I try to approach this object with beta. Suppose I take beta of z and approach e to the power minus pi. Okay, then according to this formula, what I'll get is del theta times r of z times divided by z. Divided by z times e to the power minus pi of z e to the square minus pi of z. Everything wrong. Now the pole. That beta with this object, but you give me the derivative of that function with respect to gamma. Okay? By z. So this interpretation would work if you could argue that for some reason that e to the power minus 2 phi was the operator that was derivative of delta prime. Now, e to the power minus 2 phi gives you a higher order zero. You see, it gives you square. So it's sort of like it sets even the first derivative to zero. Okay? So it's not obviously inconsistent. Okay? But as you said, you know, this is the kind of exercise that if this interpretation could be made completely kosher, and perhaps it can, there are many exercises of this sort that one would want to undergo. Okay? But it's not obvious that it's not working. And Purchinsky asserts it's true. He generally thought such things through. Okay, so it's probably true that if you do these exercises, you land at your feet. Okay? In fact, there's one such exercise that we've been trying to do. Okay, we don't have the talk today, so we'll go on for 15, 20 minutes extra. Okay, great. So let's move on. Okay, so now what we're going to try to do is to take this construction and use it to find, along the lines that Jyotirmoy was suggesting, use it to find all these points. Okay. So how do we do that? So what we need to do is to use this formula what we're going to claim is that this object, zeta, has the interpretation theta of beta. I know your reading is getting a little weird. But it's okay. You see, theta is a function that makes sense only one way. Well, it makes sense in all dimensions, but it's a local operator only in one dimension. Otherwise, it would be line operator, sheet operator. Okay? But essentially, we have one dimension because everything's additive. Everything's constant of zeta. So, theta of beta is an insertion in the path integral that sets beta to zero everywhere on the left of the insertion and, you know, leaves beta arbitrarily to the right. It's zero if theta is. Right, you can set that wrong. We shouldn't confuse the dimensionality of. Theta of beta makes sense for a real function beta. I shouldn't confuse the dimensionality. It's not theta in position space, it's theta in field space. Sorry, we'll draw that. Okay, so it just sets, you know, it's doing the integral of over only positive values of beta. Okay. Of course, the local operator, so it's very valid. It's saying that, but everywhere else you do the integral over all values of beta. But at this point, you do the integral over only positive values of beta. Okay. And I'm going to claim that this beta object can be interpreted as inserting theta of beta. Now let's see how we do this claim. I'm going to make this claim by doing the following thing. I'm going to compute gamma of z with theta of theta at zero. At zero. Okay, according to our general formula, I should get this object. The derivative of the theta function. So this should be equal to delta of theta. This should be equal to delta of beta of zero divided by z minus z, right? Blah, blah, blah. Okay? But let's see what it is if I meet this identification. So what I'm going to do is compute gamma of z times, but I'll replace gamma, so that's e to the power 5 of z, eta of z times zeta of 0. So the eta zeta CFP is the 1 over z. So as far as the pole goes, this is e to the power 5 of 0 over z plus e to the higher order. And we had that e to the power minus 5 was the delta function in gamma, but by exactly the same logic, e to the power plus 5 was the delta function in beta. Okay? So if you take this, so this is equal to this. If you take our earlier interpretations, it's correct. So that forces you to interpret, zeta, this object, zeta, 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 just by interaction. Okay? It could be theta, beta plus any function of gamma. But just from the fact that the beta, eta, CF, OP is completely non-singular, that function is non-singular. And that's completely non-singular because eta is because, the gamma, eta, what am I saying? The gamma, the beta zeta just because we have zeta and zeta. Because the beta zeta would be completely not singular. Okay, great. So we concluded that, you know, if we believe all this delta function business, we concluded that this zeta field here should be interpreted as theta. Okay? So now we're finally coming to the point. Because zeta is what we want when we compute, you know, until this. We are this. Okay, fine. So now let me immediately compute what JBRS theorem on zeta is. This whole exercise of the last 15 minutes was in order to express zeta as a known function of gamma and beta. Because then we can use just the unbosonized beta gamma expression for JBRST in order to compute that. Okay, so now we've achieved this, so we just have to proceed with them. Now it's a simple calculation. So the calculation goes as follows. We take this guy and we act on theta of beta. So firstly, it's a function only of beta. So the only non-trivial, the only singular OPs that we're going to get come from gamma. So we have to connect all the terms that involve gamma here. And act. Okay. So we've got gamma here. Now, this term has two gammas. Okay? So contracting it will give you two derivatives of the theta function. So it will give you a term that is of form beta times delta prime of beta times b times delta prime. TF times delta. also get other terms involved. Let's say, for instance, here we will get a term that is del C beta times delta beta. But that is zero because beta times delta beta is zero. Okay? So anyway, these are the only two terms of the case. Okay, so the claim is that when you work it out carefully, perhaps you should think of this just as being one thing, unless you carefully try to do it, right? And the claim was that in the end, you can work out this BRS term, and you get the answer, it's OP, and you get the answer KB Z times theta times zeta 0 is equal to minus 1 by z squared v of z delta prime of beta 0 plus 1 by z tf of z delta. Okay, so now we finally got this thing that is of interest to us, right? In particular, we find that the pole part, the part that we were really interested in, involves TF times this delta of beta of 0. Okay, delta of beta of 0, we know what that is. That formula is in Bose-Nice language, it's e to the power I. Okay, so now let's go back to our to the thing we started talking about. Okay, we were first saying that what about BRST current? You know, what about the BRS? What if we take this BRST current and surround this fake insertion of zeta field? Okay, we don't get zero. It looks like we just computed what we get. Indeed, we don't get zero. However, it is sort of obvious what's going on here. Although we don't get zero, whatever we get has no zeta left in it. This is purely functions of phi. And so it will vanish. The path integral will vanish because the integral over zeta is zero. Precisely the reason that the zeta was needed in the path integral there in the first